Please welcome Judith Dunham.
Thank you. So it's always good to give a good impression, to give a good first impression. And in fact, it's so helpful to give a good first impression to get people to think well of you, to influence them. If you can get away with it, it's even better to give a better than real first impression. To give people the impression that you're smarter, more interesting, more knowledgeable, a better candidate, a more fun date than you actually are, right? If you can get away with it. But on the other hand, for the person on the receiving end of it, this isn't so great. What they want to know is what are you actually like? You know, if you've all been through this, you've been interviewing a job candidate, you've gone on a date, you want to see, you know, try and get a sense. They seem really impressive, but is this really for real? And while this is part of our everyday experience, something we go through all the time, what I want to talk about tonight here is that in ways we don't necessarily recognize, this has been a fundamental force in evolution, in shaping really an enormous amount about all living creatures. And it also is certainly a tremendous force in human culture, and that the dynamics in this struggle, it's really almost an arms race between honesty and deception, between giving a great impression and seeing what the other, whether it's the other person, the other animal, et cetera, is really like, has also inspired an enormous amount of human invention. And it's particularly important today as we live in a world where a lot of our communication happens online, where almost all we see of others is the impression they've chosen to give off. And it also is underlying some of the deepest philosophical questions we'll be dealing with this century. So what I want to start with is this gazelle. Now, what this gazelle is doing is working on making an extremely good first impression. And the person, well, not person, the being it wants to impress is a predator. And what the very fast gazelles do, surprisingly enough, when a predator comes, is instead of running off fast, is they jump up and down. It's called stunning. And a lot of the way that this arms race between honesty and deception has played out is that it turns out that in order to for something to be a reliable signal, for it to be one of those things that you can't quite sneak around and say you're better than you are, it has to be honest enough for one who has that quality to give honestly, but too expensive, prohibitively expensive, for someone to give falsely. And so if what you're trying to say as a gazelle is, I'm so fast, I've got all the time in the world if you're coming after me. What you should do is just waste a lot of time, which is what this gazelle is doing. And in fact, the predators don't go after the ones that are doing this, and presumably they have learned that that is rather useless. Another example is this moose. It turns out that a moose uses a tremendous amount of its metabolism to grow these huge antlers and to just carry its head. Because they're so heavy. And what you can look at them, they are useful as weapons, but they're really important as communication devices. Because with two moose, especially with this kind of antlers, if they actually fight, it's really bad for both of them. Even the victor will be so badly injured that he is likely to then succumb to the next moose that comes along who wants to take his territory or his girlfriend or whatever. And so what they'd rather do is be able to signal. And so if you see one that's much bigger than you coming onto your territory, you might think, you know, I should leave. At least I wanted my territory, but I'll be alive. On the other hand, you don't want to succumb to a false signal. It has to be very reliable, because who wants to give up their territory for someone who's just saying, oh, I'm very big and strong, but they weren't. So that's why they have to have this extra costly signal, is to maintain that reliability. We do the same thing. A great deal of... Yeah, for instance, one of the things humans really like to show off is how wealthy they are. That's our form of status and strength. And so while a Corolla or a little Fiat, or the aptly named Ford Aspire, will get you from point A to point B quite well, the Bugatti will get you there also, maybe a little bit faster, maybe with, you know, a little bit more comfort, but not several hundred thousand dollars worth more. What it really does while getting you from here to there is let you show off exactly how wealthy you are, because most of us can't really afford this. But the interesting thing is, in the human world, while in the animal world, these things evolve and over time in evolution, it is an arms race, they change, things go up and down in reliability. In the human world, it turns out pretty much nothing is reliable. So first we invented cars, then we invented luxury cars, and then we invented luxury car rental. So that if that one evening it's really important for you to make an unusually good impression, you can rent it for a fraction of the cost that actually having to house and feed and drive around the Bugatti would normally cost you. It turns out, for instance, that you get more dates if you're tall. It turns out if you're an executive, you're more highly paid if you're tall. So we invented elevator shoes so that those of you who aren't tall can't pretend that you are tall. We have a multi-billion dollar industry in looking younger than you are. We have, you know, we are in a youth-driven culture. There's a lot of advantages to looking young. Not only we have makeup, we inject ourselves with toxins. We have surgery for looking younger. This is a Restylane ad. So we have all kinds of things, but it's billions of dollars in signaling that you are younger than you are. One of the sort of oldest signals that's been considered very reliable, it's the shibboleth of the Bible, is that after a certain age, about 2, it's very hard to lose the accent of your place of origin. It tells you where you're from geographically and socioeconomically. But if, given how valuable it is to appear to be from a better class or position in society, we invented elocution lessons. So even that signal, given enough effort or time, or particularly, as with all of these, it always helps if you want to fake things, enough money, you can get away with it. So in the human world, part of this arms race is that we also have punishment or social sanctioning. If I'm driving through traffic, I'm from Boston, so this is something I get to do all the time, you think it would be really nice to have a siren on your car so that you could just make everybody get out of the way. But we don't see lots of people faking being policemen. Easy it is to do. You can go on the web, say police siren, and you can buy one. But the punishment is so high, it's just not worth doing that. So we have social sanctions that range from being sent to jail, to being fined, to being ridiculed by your peers. For all kinds of things. And so this balance, this kind of arms race goes back and forth between the design of the signal and how we respond as a society to it. Today, we're living in an era where this type of evolution, cultural evolution, is going on very rapidly. Because in the era of social media, we live in a world where all of our communication is virtual. Everything we know about others is signal. And so what we get to see, to a large extent, is the impression they choose to be making. This argument, I mean, there's a million examples. We can all think of things from the dating world, et cetera, and that we sort of take home challenge to figure out and look for examples in your life or online. We'll talk about Twitter for now. Because on Twitter, well, one obvious way that you make an impression is by being witty and brief. That's enforced for you. But the other way that you make an impression, and this had certainly at first seemed like it would be very reliable, is the number of followers you have. It's a big number that sits up there, and it's sort of embarrassing if it's 4. But it's hard to, at least organically, get more followers. You actually have to be interesting, or a celebrity, or something that people actually want to follow. So that number is part of the impression you give to others. It can be highly valuable if you're a politician, you want to have a lot of followers so that it looks like you actually are going to be influential, that there's some credence given to the things you're saying. If you're a celebrity, it's particularly important because if you want to get endorsements, your endorsements grow and grow and grow, the larger your audience is. But for anyone who has something to say, giving the impression that lots of people are listening to you is one of the best ways to convince other people to listen to you also. And so, of course, once this became a valuable signal, because we're human, we came up with ways of faking it. So you could buy Twitter followers. And then this whole became an entire arms race of getting more and better followers. Because once people started buying packs of Twitter followers from people who were just setting up little Twitter armies, then Twitter said, okay, we're going to shut these down. All these like zero, you know, these like little obvious fake accounts, off they go. So now, if you go to look at the fake accounts, they're really sophisticated. They have backstories. They have tweets. They have friends. They have all kinds of social networks that they're embedded in. And in particular, and so you can watch this arms race of the bots becoming more and more sophisticated. And actually, so that it's not just a matter of like celebrities getting better endorsement. This can be literally an issue of life and death. One of the most sophisticated users of Twitter, and particularly of sort of social bot farming, is ISIS. So this is a screenshot from their, now it's been taken out of Google Play, but they had something called the Dawn app, where if you are a follower of ISIS, you would sign up, you would get news from them, you'd get all kinds of updates, and in return, what you agreed is that they could, when they wanted to, take over your Twitter account. So you would just tweet as you normally do, but when they wanted to give the impression that, you know, some announcement they had just sent out is being retweeted and retweeted, that there's thousands and thousands of people really excited about it, they had this army of very real seeming accounts that would be automated to do that. And so that's one of the most nefarious of the Twitter bot sort of combos that we're seeing more and more of. And this idea of something that's sort of half human, half bot is a really interesting piece, and it's something I think we're going to be dealing with a lot more. And the roots of this come from, you know, the work really of Alan Turing. He's the father of computing, but also of artificial intelligence. And in 1950, he wrote a paper called Computer Machinery and Intelligence, where he addressed first the question of, can machine be intelligent? And the first thing he says, you know, that's a useless question, we can't tell. It's too meaningless to address. I'm going to address the question of, like, you know, can machines seem intelligent? And that's where you get the Turing test that says a machine passes this test if a human cannot tell whether it is whether it's corresponding with a computer or another person. And he predicted that by around 2000, this would happen. It didn't quite happen then, but now we really are in the era where machines are reaching that point where they can converse with you. You know, if you've done customer service, sometimes you sit and think, am I speaking to someone who understands what they're saying, someone completely reading a script, or just a machine, you know, talking to me? It's getting increasingly harder to know. This is lovely lady was she's on Tinder. Her name is Ava. She was at South by Southwest this winter, chatting up guys there and having some very lovely conversations. And when they would say, well, let's meet somewhere, she'd say, oh, by the way, can you take a look at my Instagram account? Turns out she was actually an ad for a movie about bots. But many people fell for her. And so the question that we have to deal with here, going from thinking about the types of evolution we're dealing with now, is we're living in an era where we really need to think about, when do we care about just the signal, the words that we're seeing, how someone or something acts towards us, and when do we need to make that effort to understand what is going on in the mind behind it, if indeed there is any mind. Thank you.